Dairy is a huge part of New Zealand. It contributes massively to our economy, making up 25% of our exports. Agriculture's always been the backbone of the country, but the perception of dairy is changing.
If you care about the natural environment, whether it's climate change, whether it's biodiversity, whether it's rivers and lakes, you always end up back at agribusiness, which is driving the crisis.
Dairy cows are one of the most polluting animals you can farm, and we've filled our country with them. The massive growth of dairy over the last 30 years has come with negative impacts on our environment. Excessive fertilisers on our paddocks, pollution of our rivers, and high emissions contributing to climate change.
Our current agricultural system is very sustainable. If you compare us to other countries, we're actually one of the very best in the world.
In this series, I investigate environmental issues down on the farm and seek solutions. Farmers are part of who we are as Kiwis, and so is the love of the environment we live in. These are big issues for all of us here in Aotearoa, in the land of milk and money. Most Kiwis have probably heard our dairy industry described as intensive, but I'd guess that not that many know what that actually means. I'd always assumed it meant how many cows we have, which is partly true, but more than that, it's about the inputs that it requires to have that many cows in the first place. Things like water for irrigation, synthetic fertiliser, imported feed for cows. In this episode, I want to look at why the dairy industry uses so many inputs, and if there's a way we could reduce them that works for both farmers and environment. But first, let's get our head around what is actually intensive about our dairy industry. Put simply, it means we're keeping lots of cows tightly packed together in order to milk them twice a day. The trouble is, this limits how much grass your cows have access to, and milking cows eat a lot. Each cow eats around 80 kilograms of grass a day. The dairy boom has doubled the number of dairy cows to 6.3 million, and that's increased how many cows are kept in each paddock and put more and more pressure on the amount of grass that needs to be grown. To do that, the dairy industry's become the biggest user of water in the country and increased fertiliser use by 600% since 1990. All of these factors together are what make our dairy industry intensive. As former co-leader of the Green Party and now head of Greenpeace Aotearoa, Russel Norman's been trying to limit the number of cows we have in New Zealand to a natural capacity.
We don't exactly know how many cows we could sustain here, but it's a hell of a lot less than we have currently. What people really need to understand is that this was a completely unregulated expansion. You had whole areas of the country which just hadn't been dairy areas before, like Canterbury, Otago, Southland, were just transformed by this revolution in land use. It used to be dairy happened in places that had decent rainfall, the Waikato. What happened through the last 25 years is you got this huge expansion of irrigation, particularly in dry places that used to be sheep country. They've just converted everywhere you can possibly convert. Parallel to the great land use revolution, huge increase in number of dairy cows. Even though you're using masses of nitrogen fertilizer, you can't grow enough grass to feed them all. So you're looking for supplementary feed. So they discovered this amazing supply of cheap supplementary feed from the destroyed rainforests of Southeast Asia, which is palm kernel expeller. If you think about, you know, where are the great rainforests of the world? And some of them used to be in Southeast Asia, and a lot of those rainforests have now been destroyed. And the thing that's been destroying them is the palm oil industry. The primary driver is palm oil itself, but a huge secondary market is palm kernel expeller. And the biggest importer in the world of PKE is New Zealand. It's full of oil, it's got lots of fibre in it, and so when you give them PKE, they love it. So a lot of farmers do, and it's really cheap.
The increase in PKE usage indicates that we have more cows than we can feed off our own land. That's even with the increasing amount of fertiliser dairy farmers have used to try and grow enough grass. It's this fertiliser that leaches through the soil, down into our water table, and pollutes our rivers.
The amount of synthetic nitrogen fertiliser has gone up more than sixfold since 1990, and of course all the phosphate that we're importing from Western Sahara has gone up as well. So you've had this whole range of inputs going into the system, and put it all together and you get an environmental catastrophe.
After a decade of campaigning by Greenpeace and others, in 2020, nitrogen fertiliser use was limited to 190 kg per hectare per year. This will limit overuse of fertilisers on between a quarter and a third of dairy farms in the country.
There is huge institutional inertia. The big fertiliser companies, their business is selling people synthetic nitrogen fertiliser. There are a lot of opinions as to how much nitrogen fertiliser any farm needs, and so some farms are using dramatically more than other farms, even in similar areas with similar soils. And the fertiliser companies will sell you as much as you think you need. So we just have to intervene to change the pathway of that institution. And that means regulation by government, because the fertiliser companies aren't going to do it by themselves. Our objective is to phase it out altogether and to push it towards a regenerative model away from an industrial model.
Regenerative is a growing movement of farmers who are trying to find the natural balance between their animals and how much feed their land produces, moving away from such a heavy reliance on inputs like fertiliser and imported feed.
If you move from an industrial model to a regenerative model, then you just have much lower inputs. So you're trying to build a much more biodiverse system that relies a lot more on the living creatures within the soil in order to produce food. There's lots of studies now that look at the amount of food produced through different models, and so a regenerative model can certainly produce as much food as an industrial model.
So we're on our way to the headquarters of Ballance Agri-Nutrients, which is one of the biggest fertiliser companies in the country, to ask how we might juggle a lower input future with a business like this. How do I look? And stuff is falling away from the rural, you know, all
their... So we are a fertiliser company. We actually call ourselves a nutrient company. We supply fertiliser all over New Zealand to our farmer shareholders. We're probably 55-60% dairy. Dairy needs a higher amount of input because you have a higher amount of output.
What we have is basically all the ingredients here to make a cake. This shed pretty much exclusively comes out of North Africa, Morocco. And this is the one that we hear about. It's made the news in terms of the phosphate.
When you talk about fertilizer, you think of this chemical, but this is sand.
Yeah. Through the chemical process of impregnating it with sulfuric acid, what it does is it releases that phosphorus because for then to become water soluble and taken up by the plant. And so this is what we come through with the final product.
You produce 300,000 tonnes a year, and each of these piles is 4,000 tonnes. So you're producing about 75 of these piles here a year.
Yes.
Wow.
Western Saharan fertiliser material so controversial because in 1975, Morocco invaded the Western Sahara, taking ownership of its resources and pushing the native Sahrawi people into refugee camps, where over 170,000 people still remain. Over recent years, human rights advocates have drawn attention to Morocco's continued profit from the displacement of the Sahrawi people. And as they did, companies and whole countries swore off purchasing Western Saharan resources from Moroccan companies. New Zealand is the second largest importer of Western Saharan phosphate in the world, and one of only six countries still trading in it.
We import raw materials from four countries primarily. Our largest one is from the Western Sahara in the Moroccan area. We have South African, we have Vietnamese, and we have a bit of Chinese. The sourcing out of the Western Sahara is often put on the table as an issue of violating human rights. We travel to that region and see for ourselves that we feel ethically comfortable and we are comfortable to continue to source from that region.
You know, legally, it still actually seems a bit of a contentious issue because there's still things going through
the court. Well, legally, it's not contentious. It's very clear. The laws are set by United Nations Security Council, and New Zealand, as one of those members of United Nations, has signed up to the rules. The rules are very, very clear. It is not contentious in law.
The UN has extended a referendum on this issue over 45 times due to lack of agreement. So although it's still lawful, in March 2021, the New Zealand High Court recognised that the ongoing importation of Western Saharan phosphate poses a reputational risk to wider New Zealand interests.
It is a finite resource, but at the current rate of offtake, there's somewhere between 400 and 800 years of supply to go. We have a wicked problem. We now have too many people on the planet to do things the old-fashioned way. New Zealand has a role to continue to produce high-quality food and export that to the world.
We're really at the limit of what it seems our environment is even capable of doing. How sustainable do you think being at that limit is?
I think the sustainability at our current limit is fine. Can the farmer still be doing what we're advising in 100 years from now? And if so, then we're quite happy that the nutrient input is on a sustainable basis and the farm management practices on a sustainable basis.
How many sales reps do you have in New Zealand?
We have just over 100 sales reps. We call them nutrient specialists across New Zealand.
Do they have sales targets?
They have targets, they do.
Have those targets increased in the last 30 years?
Yes, their targets have increased in the last 30 years, but their targets are increased. They're mostly focused around acquiring new customers into Ballance as opposed to selling more to farmers. Fertiliser is usually the second most expensive input into a farming system after servicing their mortgage. So the fact that people think farmers go and buy massive amounts of fertiliser and throw it on the land is laughable. And so they're very careful how much they put on, when they put it on, and which parts of the farm they put it on.
Is our current agricultural system sustainable?
Our current agricultural system is very sustainable.
I hear Mark's point about trying to have farmers apply just the right amount to fertilisers, but considering the trajectory of our fertiliser use over the past 30 years, and the fact that we're seeing all of these downstream impacts of too many nutrients in our water, it seems that we haven't been good at applying just the right amount to fertiliser. Stan Winter's been part of the New Zealand fertiliser industry for over 50 years. At the start of the dairy boom, he suddenly felt like he was being asked to sell more fertiliser to farmers than they needed. So he left to become an independent fertiliser consultant.
As a consultant, you have freedom to say things that you might not necessarily want to be observed saying when you work for an industry. I felt it would be easier for me if I didn't have to consider how the company's policy would affect any statement I could make to a farmer. Some businesses may see that as counterproductive to their aim of selling fertilisers to do such a thing, or some other type of agricultural chemical. This is home for me, the man cave.
It's so great. I wish I had something like this.
No, you don't. Believe me.
What, a lab in my basement?
Yes.
That's the dream.
It is handy, I must say, yes. As a former producer of ag chems, fertilisers mainly, of course, it does concern me that maybe I've contributed to some of the degradation that's becoming obvious. So it'd be nice to be part of the recovery process as well. Quick look at the soil here so we can see where the fertiliser goes and what it has to do.
Why is it that we need to apply fertilisers to our pastures?
The main reason that farmers do it is normally to replace losses from production. In the particular case of dairying, the animals will consume the grass and maybe half of that will pass through the cow,
right,
be deposited back in the paddock. On the other stage, they make milk and some of the nutrients in the grass will be present in the milk. So that's where the main loss is.
Where does the fertiliser come into that calculation?
Generally, fertilisers are inefficiently used, so they start to have residues that accumulate.
So it's not that fertilisers are bad, it's that we're using them badly.
I think that's pretty fair, yes. When I left the industry, we'd have been selling 50,000 tonnes of nitrogen a year, and now it's getting up towards 450,000 tonnes. From a lot of the trial work I had done, it was quite obvious that in some areas we were starting to use too much, but apparently there's not a much bigger increase in production for that extra input. So that's a worry for me.
So Stan turned his mind to how farmers could reduce their reliance on nitrogen fertiliser and found the past held some answers. Instead of grass monoculture, cows can eat a salad of different grasses and plants which provide different nutrients. Clover, for instance, is a plant that increases nitrogen uptake on pastures.
When I was a younger man, we used to tell farmers how good we were, not being like the crazy Europeans who paid for nitrogen out of a bag. We used to get ours free from the atmosphere using our clovers. Now, we're the crazy ones getting nitrogen out of a bag, and it's the Europeans who have gone back to getting it from clovers.
Stan has found simple, old-fashioned mechanical methods can also reduce the need for chemical fertilisers. And it's free as air.
In this little slide I have here, it was one of the first experiments we did with soil aeration. And you can see that the half of the paddock that's been aerated has started to grow nice green clovers and ryegrasses. The other half of the paddock has totally senesced and gone to seed. And that was nothing to do with fertilisers, it was simply reintroducing air. So we need to go back to getting something for free if we can.
The average age of farmers in New Zealand is in their 50s, so many have experienced two different eras of New Zealand farming, the dairy era now and the sheep era before. While we only have 6.3 million dairy cows, they eat roughly the same as 35 million sheep. Sheep also don't have to be kept around a central location like a dairy shed, which means you can spread them out further and give the grass more of a natural chance to grow. I was hosted by a group of farmers involved in the Rural Support Trust. Many have experienced these two modern eras of New Zealand farming and had to grapple with this new input-reliant model.
I've come from a sheep and beef background, and as a sheep and beef farmer, everyone loved me, and as soon as I went dairy farming, the attitude was just different. The problem with Canterbury is, because of the irrigation, it's very visual, so a lot of people have seen a real change in the landscape over the last 10 or 20 years, because not just the sheep have disappeared and the cows have arrived, but centre pivots have come onto the plains and people can see that. And I would argue the best thing that can be done with the Canterbury Plains, which is very free draining with beautiful alluvial soils, is to irrigate it and put a pasture on that. Now, whether dairy cows are eating that pasture or sheep are eating that pasture, I guess we'll have to decide. And there is issues with nitrogen. I mean, I'm not going to deny that.
How have your inputs shifted?
Per kilogram of product that goes off my farm, my inputs have reduced. And that's what really counts at the end of the day. That's more important than anything.
But what are you putting on the land? How have your inputs changed?
Well, I'm still putting on fertiliser on. I'm putting on nitrogen onto my land. And I've still got cows grazing paddock. So...
But I guess that's the big thing, isn't it? Is that intensive dairy requires far more input than extensive sheep and beef does.
Well, if you're getting more product, then in fact, are you actually putting more on? Aren't you more efficient and you're actually really putting less on?
If you go back and look at the palm kernel argument or the palm kernel usage, there's no doubt as part of our values, we wanted to reduce the input of that. We've done that. But to compensate from a feed perspective, we've increased our nitrogen use. We've also increased our cropping. That's great, we're growing it off our own land, but I don't know the environmental impact that has versus my truckloads
of palm kernel
of PKA, yeah.
Inputs equate to about 20% of dairy farmers' outgoings. Isn't there a version of having less cows and reducing those input costs?
We've actually doubled our production in 25 years with 10% more cows. If we were producing what we did 25 years ago, it's not sustainable. It has to be sustainable economically as well.
We're not some massively evil group of people destroying New Zealand. Because we're not. Have we got room for improvement? Of course we have. We can't just change the entire farming practices of all New Zealanders immediately. But you never underestimate a dairy farmer. I think that the change in the last 10 years is quite incredible.
Oh, it is.
I mean, you go onto farms now, look, just coming in, Mark, just coming into your place, beautifully planted up all the waterways. That was an uncommon thing to see 10 years ago. It is quite common to see that now. It isn't going to happen like that. It's going to take time.
Many of the worst impacts of the dairy industry can be traced back to these inputs: water, fertilizer, and supplementary feed. We just use them at a scale that degrades the environment and causes ethical and sustainability concerns. In the next episode, we'll look at the emissions of our cows and the role they're playing in the climate crisis.